Link TV, connecting you to the world. Link TV is viewer supported. Watch more at linktv.org.
Link TV presents Mosaic World News from the Middle East. Here are today's top stories.
Turkey shuts its airspace to Israeli military flights. 10 alleged Russian spies arrested in the United States. And Iraq arrests gang of counterfeiters. Mosaic World News from the Middle East begins now.
Ankara decided to close its airspace to Israeli military planes and said that requests for Israeli flights to enter Turkey will be assessed on a case-by-case basis. Turkish Prime Minister Recep Tayyip Erdogan confirmed on the sidelines of the G20 summit in Toronto, Canada, that Turkey has imposed a ban on Israeli military aircraft from using Turkish airspace.
The Turkish-Israeli military relations had proceeded for decades without any tension between the two countries. But it appears that the Israeli attack on the aid flotilla headed to the Gaza Strip last month, during which 9 Turks were killed, has somewhat affected this military cooperation. The Turkish leaders revealed that Israeli military planes now have to get a permit every time they want to use the Turkish airspace, and that each case will be dealt with separately. This comes after media reports said that Turkey prevented an Israeli military plane en route to Poland from passing through its airspace.
I don't know about the media reports, but yes, we do have a ban pertaining to Israeli military airplanes passing through Turkish airspace. This ban was issued after the recent incidents, and it was announced indeed.
Turkey has recalled its ambassador from Israel and has canceled joint military drills with Israel as a response to the attack on the Freedom Flotilla. Turkey also announced that it intends to reduce its military and commercial bonds with Israel if Israel does not give an official apology for what happened. Despite the high tension that followed the attack on the Freedom Flotilla, a Turkish security delegation visited Israel recently to test the drones bought from Israeli companies. Israel's war on Gaza more than a year ago affected Turkish-Israeli relations. The controversy around this war was the reason why Turkish Prime Minister Recep Tayyip Erdogan stormed out of the Davos Forum early in 2009 after a verbal altercation with Israeli President Shimon Peres. Following these incidents, Turkey got closer with Arab countries and Iran. According to the Turkish strategy, its national and security interests can be achieved with more cooperation with these two sides. To put things into perspective, the volume of trade between Turkey and the Arab world increased from $8.5 billion in 2002 to $37 billion in 2008, and the volume of trade between Turkey and Israel decreased from $3.5 billion in 2008 to $2.5 billion in 2009. Political observers explain that Turkey has the dilemma of depending on foreign military industries and expertise to arm and train its army since it signed the military cooperation agreement with Israel in February 1996. This military agreement remains an impetus for the Turkish-Israeli alliance, which began since its signing.
Recent headline news pertaining to relations between Washington and Moscow are similar to those that were once used during the Cold War. Today, the CIA revealed that it dismantled a 10-person spy ring who worked during the past 10 years for Moscow. Many details are still secret, but what has been disclosed already was sufficient to create a new storm in the relations between the White House and the Kremlin. We leave you with Muna Abu Diab.
The story started many years ago in Moscow and ended here, in one of New York's neighborhoods, and in this home, to be exact. For the past 10 years, this home was viewed as the headquarters of two Russian spies.
We used to see them in the neighborhood. They were calm and did not raise any attention. The only thing we heard from their home was the sound of their dogs barking at night.
وإلى منزل في مدينة نيويورك انضمت منازل أخرى تناثرت عناوينها بين
بوسطن. There are other homes in addition to this one. Some were in Boston, New Jersey, and Virginia. The CIA established control over these homes and arrested the owners. According to the American story, the 10 Russian spies have worked for the past 30 years for the Kremlin.
عملت على مدى 30 عاما لصالح الكرملين.
I'm just completely in shock.
إنني مصدومة تماما لم أكن.
I'm just completely in shock. I never expected something like this from a good and very peaceful family. Their kids played a lot with our kids. Their young daughters are wonderful. We are shocked by the news.
الانخراط في المجتمع الأمريكي تكتيك عمدت إليه المجموعة التي تنوع جنسيات.
Members of the spy ring have worked into integrating into the American society. Some have Canadian, Russian, and Peruvian passports. According to the CIA, the group was trained by the Russian intelligence agency with the objective of penetrating American institutions and gathering critical information about the U.S. for Moscow.
لصالح موسكو تهمة تضع الموقوفين العشرة في مواجهة أحكام بالسجن تصل إلى.
The charges might land the 10 defendants up to 25 years in prison. In addition, all of them are also accused of money laundering, except for one individual. Until the court procedures, which may take weeks or even months, American analysts are focusing on the latest pictures of the Russian and American presidents.
تحليلاتهم للقصة الجاسوسية الروسية على الصور الأخيرة لرئيسهم ونظيره.
These pictures were taken a few days ago and were viewed as evidence to a new era between the two countries.
كتوثيق لعصر جديد في العلاقات بين البلدين.
روسيا اختارت الرد على الإعلان الأمريكي بداية دون تأكيد أو نفي لوجود.
Russia refrained from making comments about the alleged American accusation of the Russian spy ring. Russian intelligence said that they will not comment on the American information, thus paving the way for the foreign ministry to respond. At the beginning, the Russian foreign ministry said that the American reports are contradictory. But later, Foreign Minister Sergei Lavrov said that Russia is waiting for an explanation from Washington pertaining to the spy ring. Lavrov criticized the American timing, sarcastically said that it was wonderful timing. Then a Russian statement was released saying that the American reports are baseless.
هم لم يوضحوا المسألة لنا وأمل أن.
We had no explanation, but I hope we will receive one. What I can say now is that the timing of this announcement was most elegant.
تم اختياره بلباقة خاصة.
Israeli Foreign Minister Avigdor Lieberman said that there is no chance that a Palestinian state would be established in the next 2 years.
Lieberman said that during a joint press conference with Russian Foreign Minister Sergei Lavrov, adding that, based on what is happening on the ground, it would be unlikely to reach an agreement that would allow for the establishment of a Palestinian state before 2012.
كشخص متفائل لا أرى أي احتمال لقيام دولة فلسطينية.
As an optimist, I see no chance that a Palestinian state will be established by 2012. We can express interest, we can dream, but in reality we are still far from reaching understandings and agreements on establishing an independent state by 2012.
The Russian Foreign Minister Sergei Lavrov called for refraining from taking any steps that may create tensions before a final status agreement is reached on Jerusalem.
This comes as the Jerusalem District Planning and Building Committee is set to approve a new master plan in the coming weeks that calls for the expansion of Jewish settlements in East Jerusalem in order to link it with West Jerusalem. المحيطة بها إلى القدس
الغربية. مراسلنا الياس كرام وتفاصيل. More details about the Israeli plan to control all Jerusalem from our reporter Elias Karam.
هو قلب لموازين الديموغرافيا والجغرافيا وتشويه للتاريخ والهوية.
Its aim is to change demographic and geographic realities on the ground, as well as erasing the Arab identity of East Jerusalem. The borders marking East and West Jerusalem will also be deleted. This is what the Palestinians are saying about the new Israeli master plan for Jerusalem, known as 2020.
المخطط هو الأول من نوعه منذ سقوط القدس بقبضة الاحتلال.
This is the first master plan of its kind since Jerusalem fell in the hands of the occupation in 1967. It calls for expanding existing settlements and building an additional 58,000 settlement units, as well as for linking settlements around East Jerusalem with streets, tunnels, and train tracks, as well as technology parks and industrial zones.
The Palestinians see the plan as a lethal blow. It is a clear message to the Palestinians that Jerusalem will not be included in the peace negotiations. Israel wants to maintain sovereignty in both East and West Jerusalem and make it its eternal capital. And it wants to keep the city with an absolute Jewish majority and a small Arab minority.
Arabs do not exist on this map. The Jerusalem municipality allows settlement construction in the heart of Arab neighborhoods. The new master plan strengthens Jewish control over the old city and enables them to surround the noble sanctuary with what is known as the biblical gardens.
The plan does not take into consideration Palestinian natural population growth, and it does not provide them with construction licenses.
The Palestinians said that revealing this master plan at this point may deliver a fatal blow to the entire peace process.
The continuation of these Israeli policies is destructive and dangerous and obstructs American efforts aimed at resuming the peace process.
By 2020, the demographic balance will be transformed to the advantage of the Jews. They will comprise 88% of Jerusalem's population, while Palestinians will only be 12%. Israel does not mean anything without Jerusalem, and Jerusalem does not mean anything without the Temple. This statement was made by Ben-Gurion many decades ago, and now it is being implemented on the ground through plans and policies with the objective of making it impossible to divide Jerusalem on the ground. Ilyas Karam, Al Jazeera, Occupy Jerusalem.
The Shin Bet Security Service today announced the arrest of 7 Israeli Arabs from Nazareth for a series of terrorist attacks, including murder. The cell was described by a senior police officer as one of the most dangerous ever uncovered. The 7 suspects, ranging in age from 19 to 23, were remanded in custody in Nazareth District Court for another month and a half. The security services said the suspects were involved in the murder of taxi driver Yafim Weinstein last November. The 54-year-old resident of Nazareth Elite was found dead in his taxi cab outside Kfar HaChorish. Some details of the investigation remain under wraps, but the Shin Bet said the group is linked to Al-Qaeda and global jihad.
Soraida was a Palestinian woman who was murdered in 2002 by Israeli soldiers in the West Bank city of Ramallah. She was shot dead while in a car with her husband and infant child. 8 years have now passed, and her bereaved family is still in Israeli courts seeking justice for her cold-blooded murder. Shirin Yassin has the details.
10 years have passed since the second uprising or intifada broke out in September as part of the Palestinian struggle against the Israeli occupation. A lot of people are still licking their wounds, people who were injured or whose houses were destroyed, or those who lost loved ones. Stories of witnesses and survivors are all over the place, and only someone needs to ask what the story is behind these closed doors. Murad Abu Gharbiyeh, however, did not wait for someone to ask. He brought to court his case against the Israeli army, killing his wife back in 2002. He had witnessed Israeli soldiers as they murdered his wife Suraida in West Bank's Ramallah from a zero distance while she was carrying her infant in her arms.
An Israeli soldier broke the car's window and shot. I got wounded and my wife was shot at the back of her head and was killed.
Suraida was a Palestinian with an American citizenship. After the incident, the bereaved family headed to courts in the U.S. seeking justice, but the case was dropped. They claimed that because another case was opened in Israel, they couldn't accept it. And the Israeli court is still postponing the case, claiming they need to gather more evidence.
Palestinians have a different law in Israeli courts than the Israelis, so the Israeli courts deal with the Palestinian cases based on Israel's interest and its security and not on the evidence and what's right and just.
Mohsen was only a few months old when his mother was killed. He was fast asleep at the time, but he woke up only to find out that his mother was gone. He will turn 9 soon, and for the 9th year, he will remember why his mother is not there to watch him blow his birthday candles.
I lost my mother and I miss her so much. Other children have mothers, but my father tries to do his best to compensate for the loss of my mother.
Abu Gharbiya says the memories of that day are still chasing him. And for 7 years, now his case is still in Israeli courts, investigating the murder that took only 7 minutes, according to him. This man is not looking only for justice or compensation. He is looking for a way to get over the traumatic experience that changed his life and his family's forever. Shirin Yassin, Press TV, Ramallah.
The King of Saudi Arabia, Abdullah bin Abdulaziz, meets with the U.S. President Barack Obama today in Washington. The two will discuss the Palestinian-Israeli peace process, as well as the Iranian nuclear issue and economic cooperation between the two countries.
From the peace process to Iraq and Iran, the United States Department of State follows the Middle East affairs closely, and Saudi Arabia has a say in these issues. All these are on the agenda of the summit between the Saudi King and the U.S. President.
There are enduring issues that we talk to the leaders of Saudi Arabia about on a regular basis. When the Secretary was in the region earlier this year, she had a lengthy bilateral talk with King Abdullah. And we talked about the situation with respect to Iran. We talked about the status of the peace process, including the importance of the Arab Peace Initiative. We talked about the relations that Saudi Arabia has with other countries in the region, including Iraq.
The bilateral relations between the United States and Saudi Arabia witnessed steady progress during the last 2 years. The two countries also increased their commercial and cultural exchanges, and the number of Saudi Arabian students in the United States rose to 25,000. But these relations do not always go in a straight line.
I think they improved overnight when Obama became president, simply because he's not George Bush. The same can be said for Iraq. There was a failure after the Cairo speech because nothing happened in terms of the Palestinian cause, and settlements continued.
The Obama administration largely relies on King Abdullah's initiative on the peace process in the Middle East. The United States wants the indirect negotiations to turn into direct negotiations between the Palestinians and Israelis, perhaps through convening a peace conference modeled after the Madrid conference. At the same time, the United States needs to follow its plan to withdraw from Iraq.
They need Saudi support to gain diplomatic support to the independent Iraqi government, as well as financial support such as canceling foreign debts and providing more Saudi investments.
Saudi Arabia and Washington both remain very concerned pertaining to Tehran's nuclear program and its lack of response towards the international community. Washington is worried that Iran may obtain a nuclear weapon and become a real threat to its neighbors. All these issues will be on the discussion table of the Saudi-U.S. summit.
The Assistant Secretary General of the Arab League for Economic Affairs, Ibrahim Al-Twigri, said that the upcoming economic forum set to take place in October will discuss the recommendations of the Arab Economic Summit in preparation for their implementation in 2015. Al-Twigri's statements came during his visit to the Council of Economic Unity and following his meeting with Ambassador Mohammed Rabia, the Council's new Secretary General.
During his visit to the headquarters of the Council of Economic Unity, the Assistant Secretary General of the Arab League for Economic Affairs' most important discovery was the existence of a gap in the coordination between the Council, as an organization that includes 48 Arab specialized unions and the main Arab League. This led to the obstruction of the Council's fulfillment of its role.
I had said that the first thing I will tackle after becoming Secretary General is to take the Council of Arab Economic Unity back to its principal role, not through the independence of the Council, rather by taking this Council back under the umbrella of the main organization, the League of Arab States.
Following the criticism of the Economic Summit, the coordination has become more efficient. The efforts are stronger, and there is more coordination between us, between the Council of Unity in the Arab League.
With the beginning of a new chapter, the meeting was about five main issues related to food safety, the linking of Arab roads, electricity networks, financial institutions, and the establishment of the Arab Customs Union in order to finally establish the Arab Common Market.
After we established the Customs Union in 2015, there is a proposed plan to establish the Arab Common Market by 2020 or 2022.
The meeting between the two men also uncovered the will to increase the number of member states in the Council of Economic Unity, increasing it from a mere nine countries to encompass all Arab states, in addition to the inclusion of the private sector in the Arab Common Market. After resolving the issues between the Arab League and the Council of Economic Unity, the Council's new Secretary General is hoping that his Council will implement the policies of the Arab League in all economic matters, an attempt that remains dependent on the return of all Arab states to this new Council. Ahmed Waghi, Nile TV.
The Secretary General of the Organization of Petroleum Exporting Countries, OPEC, Abdallah El-Badri, said that the current price of oil is comfortable. He also said that he expects the current output to be maintained until next October. El-Badri's comments came before his meeting with the EU Commissioner for Energy, Günther Oettinger, during which both sides looked into cooperating in order to reduce the price of crude oil in light of the many factors that are causing the fluctuation of the world's oil prices.
The head of the U.S. Military Command Center in the area of Abu Ghraib, Brigadier General Darnell Wright, said that his forces will withdraw from Iraq as scheduled. Wright praised the capabilities of the Iraqi security forces and their readiness to take over the security responsibility.
It's known that the U.S. forces are currently at the transitional stage prior to the full withdrawal from Iraq, and that all combat operations will come to an end on September 1st. My brigade will be the last combat force to leave Iraq, bringing the number of U.S. troops in Iraq to 50,000. We can reach this goal in cooperation with the Iraqi security forces. Iraqis must trust their security forces in their takeover of all security responsibilities.
On the ground, four Iraqi citizens, including two women, were killed and eight others were wounded in sporadic terrorist attacks in Baghdad. A security source said that two police officers were martyred and four others were wounded while trying to dismantle a bomb planted on Sheikh Omar Street. In a separate incident, two women were martyred and four residents were wounded in a terrorist attack on a home in the Sahabi neighborhood of Doura. In addition, a resident was wounded in a sticky bomb attack that targeted a private car in the Karada neighborhood.
As part of its campaign to fight crime and pursue the criminals, the Muthena Provincial Police arrested a gang specializing in the counterfeiting of currency.
The security leaders in the province said that the arrest was made after carrying out surveillance and monitoring the suspects' activities. The police also seized an unspecified amount of forged money during the arrest.
Due to the efforts of the Muthena Provincial Police to pursue anyone trying to undermine the security and economic viability of the province, a special criminal investigative unit arrested a gang suspected of counterfeiting currency. The police also seized an unspecified amount of 10,000 dinar notes allegedly counterfeited outside the province to be circulated in the market.
We've been following these individuals for a while. Members of the Counterterrorism Task Force and National Information Division were able to track down these individuals who are in the business of counterfeiting money.
وكانت مديرية شرطة المحافظة قد كثفت خلال الفترة.
The Muthanna Provincial Police Department has recently intensified its efforts aimed at cracking down on the misuse of public money and on economic crime, which started to emerge after security was fully restored in the province. In response, the security agencies are exerting efforts to crack down on crime and protect public property. The Muthanna Police said that they will continue to move forward with a plan to build and develop the infrastructure of the security agencies in the province.
In 2009,
we set aside a budget to launch three projects. We built a police station in the area of Al Abeid in Kishra, in the city of Samawa. In addition, we built another station in the city of Rumais, and a third police center was established in the district of Hilal.
The security achievements of the Muthanna Provincial Police Department will continue to increase day by day. The process of the construction and the development of the security infrastructure entered its final stage. The activation of the intelligence role was a key factor in the success of the new security plan and strategy, which has proven to be effective in the protection and security of the province as a whole. Farah Jabouri, Iraqiya, Muthanna.
The views expressed on Mosaic are from contributing broadcasters, not Link TV or its sponsors. The production of Mosaic is made possible from support of viewers like you. Thank you. Watch Mosaic World News online, stay up to date with breaking news, read our blog, get transcripts of past shows and more at linktv.org/mosaic.
This program is brought to you by Link TV for educational and non-commercial use only. Link TV is the only U.S. network dedicated to global and national news, uncompromising documentaries, and diverse cultural programs, programs which connect you to the world.